Hello everybody, I'm Magnus Jansson. I'm the Market Communications Manager at Westermo. We have an anniversary coming up. Westermo in the UK will be 25 years in May 2020. And I think that this is a good opportunity to talk to Alan Bollard, who started Westermo in the UK in 1995, and he's still the Managing Director there today. Can you please give a bit of background? How did you first come in contact with Westermo, and can you tell me how you got to start the first office outside Sweden?
Sure. Well, I mean, that takes us back an awful long time, and in fact, even earlier than the 25 years that we're about to celebrate. When I was in my 20s, I was working for a company called Electroustic. I think the company still actually exists, but I think it's got new owners and does new things. Mm-hmm. But I joined that company to actually work with data communications products. And there was a number of brands being offered by that company. And one of them was actually Westermo. But we didn't sell very much of the Westermo products. But over the period of a few years, when I was talking to the customers who were buying the Westermo products, it kept striking me that it was always good news. They were very happy about the quality of the product. They were happy that the goods were delivered on time. And they were very happy that they always got good answers to questions from this company. And that made me think this was a very small part of the business with this distributor, but I felt that there was a much bigger opportunity for Westermo. So over time, I started to speak to more and more people at Westermo, getting to know them. One particular guy, Kenneth Isaacson, who's worked for the company even longer than I have. Mm-hmm. We sat down one evening following a trade show in Aberdeen, and we discussed this. And we came to the conclusion that actually what we needed to do was set up a company in the UK. And if I could do that, then I could spend 100% of my time promoting the Westermo product range. Basically, that was really the start of it. Discussions with the then owners of the company, Tora Anderson, led us to creating Westermo UK. And then we opened the office back in May 1995. I built the business up, very small to start with, working on my own. I employed one person and then another person. And gradually the business grew. Nothing exponential, but good, steady growth every year. We grew the business year on year for many, many years. And one thing I'm also very proud of is the fact that we've been profitable every single year. And that's enabled us to keep growing the business.
What do you appreciate the most working for Westermo?
Fundamentally, what you look at, every day that you stay at a company is does that company's core values still really matter? And the things I've always liked about Westermo still stay true. There's great people working there. We do something, for the world. We produce products that are important. We produce things that are used by, utility companies, rail companies. We help to make the world tick. And that gives a great deal of satisfaction.
Taking you back in time a bit, when you started out, do you remember your first sale or first notable sale? And can you tell me something about that story?
I've actually got a pretty good idea what the first sale for Westermo UK was. We sold four of a product called the MA44, which was an RS232 to 485 converter. Actually, when you start up a business, the first order is something which you're desperate to get. And it did take a couple of days before that order actually came in. I mean, we had been trading with Westermo in the UK before the company started. So I knew orders would come. But it's okay, where's that first order going to come from? And that was quite good because it came from a company which, and it was a new customer actually, I'd never dealt with before, but it had been the result of basically picking up a list of potential customers and just picking the phone up and ringing round, explaining what we did and what we had. And I guess I just got lucky, found an opportunity that these guys needed some of these units. I had them available. The order came in, I shipped it, and bingo, we had our first order. That's a very, very proud moment when you actually ship those first units and raise that first invoice. You're on the road.
Yeah, I can imagine.
That's that. Really the starting point when you get that first order.
In what ways has the market changed over time, do you think?
I mean, you know, the market for industrial data communications has changed tremendously, but also the business's climate and the way that you do business has changed tremendously. I mean, it might be hard to believe that, you know, when we first started Westermo, very few companies had a website. We certainly didn't. Didn't have an email account, so nothing came via email. You know, it was all very much telephones, fax machines, and, you know, marketing was, you know, very much printed. And that has changed absolutely incredibly. You know, now we wouldn't dream of not having a website. We're talking, you know, talking video communications here, which you couldn't dream of back in 1995. If someone said you were going to regularly have video calls to other countries, people would have looked at you a bit strangely, as if how on earth can that work? And now look, we're just doing it normally. It's just second nature. So I mean, you know, the business world has changed. But also, you know, in terms of the industrial data communications market, I mean, that's evolved a great deal as well. You know, back in the days in 1995, we were talking serial comms, 232.485, running at 2,400 bits per second or 9,600 bits per second. It was, compared to today, incredibly slow. But over the years, things like Ethernet came along, and routers, and, you know, the mobile phone networks, first of all, GPRS, then, you know, 3G, 4G. Mm. And suddenly we're now finding ourselves where, you know, the lowest speeds people are talking about are up around 100 megabits per second.
Yeah.
You know, huge increase in speed. I think it's something like about 10,000 times faster data rates today, as opposed to when we started. Nevertheless, it's incredible the amount of equipment still out there that's still running on these old serial protocols. The world does rely very heavily on equipment that's been installed for many, many years. So one of the big things that Westermo now does is manage the legacy along with the new technologies, and often provide solutions to join the two together. And that's a very important part of our business.
So over the 25 years that you have been in the business, there must be some real customer success stories. Is there anyone in particular that stands out that you can tell me about?
I mean, over the years, there's obviously been many cases, but one that does come to mind that always kind of makes me smile a bit is a case where we were dealing with a utility company, and they were trying to establish a connection between one site and another site. The problem is one of those locations was actually at the bottom of a cliff, and they had been looking at all sorts of technologies, and they'd been trying wireless. And the problem with wireless is you need a line of sight, and because of the nature of the topology of the land, that was impossible. So they'd been considering installing a fiber optic cable from this site and down the front of this cliff to reach this this external site. Now, they'd been quoted to do this job of a sum, I understand, somewhere in the region of £750,000 to £1 million. So just to get the data from this outfall, which was a legal requirement for them, it was going to cost them a lot of money. And at that particular time, Westermo had just released a new product that we now call the Wolverine, which basically allows you to get Ethernet data communications on some old twisted pair cable. Now, these products were pretty new at the time, and one of the sales guys went to see the customer and just talked around these products, and somebody remembered that they'd seen, when they were doing the surveys for this fiber optic installation, there was in fact an old telephone line which apparently during the Second World War had been put down the cliff so that somebody could ring back if they saw something unusual happening. And it turned out that this cable, this telephone cable, still existed down the front of this cliff. A couple of units were installed, one at each end, and lo and behold, an Ethernet connection was established between these two sites. A couple of units, which probably in total cost around about £1,000, and the customer had a working solution. And no longer did he need to spend nearly £1 million putting a fiber optic cable in. And, you know, that was a fantastic problem solving solution from Westermo, and it's always one that makes me laugh, you know, even now, at just about how much money you can save if you have the right product at the right time. And I always question whether or not actually the price we charged for them at the time was way too low on that particular application.
You have seen how industrial data communication has evolved over the last 25 years. What are your thoughts on data communication in the coming period, and how do you think Westermo UK will be able to support this?
Well, I mean, I think sometimes we see data comms moving quite slowly, but in reality, it moves quite quickly. You know, we often talk about the way that data rates have increased from 9,600 to 100 megabit per second. And, you know, one area that we're seeing a lot now is that the want to connect more and more remote equipment. And people have talked about 4G, and we hear a lot about 5G. And that's going to have incredible bandwidth. However, I do actually think 4G will be with us for a long time because it's got a lot more capabilities to handle data comms into remote locations. That the frequency spectrums that it uses, I think, are much better for remote communication. So I see 4G as being there for a long time. But I think when you use them in combination as 4G and 5G, as I think will come along in a few years' time, you're going to have great solutions for remote telemetry systems, which are going to be able to connect vast numbers of bits of equipment together. And I mean, there will be a 6G. I have no idea what the technology will be that will drive that and how fast it will go. But I am certain that as time goes by, we're going to see, you know, more wireless communications coming along. I think another area that could be interesting, and it's a bit left field and it's not something that really talked about too much at Westermo so far, but I mean, I'm looking at things like satellites. I've seen satellite comms used in utilities for quite some time. One of the big issues that comes back with those is that the geostationary satellites that tend to get used have got a very, very high orbit. They're a long way above the planet, and that just creates latency. The data takes a long time to go up and down. Mm-hmm. And for many industrial protocols, that latency can be a bit of a problem. Now, we are starting to see quite a number of companies trying to launch low Earth orbit satellites. But in order to give the coverage, they need large numbers of these big clusters. But there are three or four companies out there who are trying to get these satellite networks up with the view that they're going to be able to provide broadband to areas of the world that could never have broadband before. That could be very interesting for some of our customers who do want high-speed data communications in unusual places. But this could still be a few years away before we get anywhere with it. But, you know, if you're thinking about the future, I think that's an interesting technology to keep an eye on. Not something I think we're going to see products for some time. But I do think it's a technology that could be considered in, you know, 5 to 10 years for remote telemetry systems.